हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी विल डू द लाइन कोडिंग और रेस्ट ऑफ द लाइन कोडिंग वी विल डू लाइक एचडीबी एंड बीएचजेडएस लाइन लाइन कोड एंड आल्सो वी विल आल्सो डिस्कस द वेरियस एडवांटेजेस एंड डिसएडवांटेजेस ऑफ वेरियस योर लाइन कोड्स देन कंपैरिजन ऑफ दैट देन वी विल डू द आईएसआई एंड योर आई पैटर्न. Okay, so firstly, high density bipolar signaling is actually in case of we know that bipolar NRZ or AMI signal, the transmitted signal, your transmitted signal is equal to zero in that case when a binary zero is transmitted. And this is true in the case of unipolar RZ and unipolar NRZ as well. So absence of the signal sometimes cause the problems in the synchronization at the receiver. If long sequences of your binary zeros are being transmitted, so this problem actually can be solved by adding a special sequence. And when long strings of zeros exceeding a number of n are being transmitted, so this type of coding is known as your high density bipolar coding, and in short form it is written as HDB. Okay. And where capital N, so where capital N can be your 1, 2, 3 means number of zeros can be 1, 2, 3 and the sequence which have to be added, that is 1, 2, 3. Okay, and the most widely HDB format to use is your HDB 3. Okay, HDB 3. So now come on to the waveform. Okay, now come on to the waveform. You can see we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 zeros, and here 4 zeros, consecutive 4 zeros. So if your zeros are more than 3, you can see n is small, n is equal to 3, then we have to add a special sequence for that. Okay, so in the string of message bits, where capital N plus 1, that is your 3 plus 1 is 4, or minimum number of zeros occur, means we have the minimum number of zeros is your 4 and your maximum number of zeros in this case is your 10. So you can see that if they can be replaced by n plus 1 sequence of length. So means if there are 4 zeros, then we have to replace that with the special sequence like 000V. Okay, these are the special sequences. It can be in any form, where we can use 000V, or we can use also 100V, or here we can also 100V, and so on. And rest of the two will be written like this. And we have to plot the, how we will plot this. Firstly, we will plot AMI signal. So for first one, we will write the bipolar NRZ we will make for this. So for first one, we will be high signal, for zero it will be zero. Okay, and then the alternate mark inversion is to be drawn. So for first one, that is your high, and for second one it will be negative, for next one it will be your positive. Okay, and for four zeros we have to add this type of sequence, that 000V and 000. V can be your one or V can be your negative. Okay, we can be your one, we can be your negative. Okay, this is in the case of your negative polarity. Okay, next, this is, now you have seen that this is positive, this is negative, this is positive. So if I am taking V as one, so this is in again the alternate mark inversion as negative polarity. Okay, now come on to next, this will be the negative polarity, this one is in the negative polarity, we can be zero or one. Okay, but in this case we are plotting the negative polarity. So this is positive, this is negative, this is again for consecutive one is your positive, then this will be negative. So for other ones it will be positive, negative, then positive. For 00 it will be, I have also added the special sequence for this for these four zeros. Okay, so it is, now we will use 100V. This is arbitrary, you can use. Okay, so here it is one, then 00, then is again V is I am also considering the V as a with the negative polarity again. So this was the positive one, this was the negative polarity. So next is your, again I am adding the special sequence of four next four zeros as 100V. So 100V means that is if you have positive polarity here, then you have to draw the negative polarity. Okay, next 400 it will be your 00. So in the string of your message bits, when n plus one or minimum number of zeros occur, they can be replaced by a special binary sequence. It can be your 000V. It can be your 100V. Okay. So this was your HDB signaling, and most common HDB signaling uses HDB3 signaling. Okay. So next is your B8ZS. Next is your B8ZS line code. Okay. So actually, we know that in order to have the synchronization actually between your transmitter and receiver, the line code needs to cross the zero line frequently. Means this zero line should be crossed frequently. Okay. But actually, as per the actually standard, some US standard, not more than 15 zeros can be sent in succession. Means we can't send more than 15 zeros in the succession to ensure the proper synchronization. So in order to solve these type of problems related to the synchronization, a line code which is introduced, that is the B8ZS. Full form for that is binary 8. B stands for binary 8 bit. Means we are considering the eight consecutive zeros. So 8 zeros suppression. Z for zeros, S for suppression. Okay. This type of line code was developed to make the ensure the synchronization. So whenever 8 successive zeros are detected, the implementation of this code will automatically insert a special bit 8-bit sequence code. In the previous HDB3, you have seen where a special sequence is inserted for the consecutive 4 zeros. But in this case, we have the consecutive 8 zeros, and the special sequence will also be of your 8-bit sequence. Okay. So this can be easily detected and corrected by your two units. One is your CSU, second is your DSU. CSU stands for channel service unit, and DSU stands for your data service unit. Okay, next come on to the waveform. Now you can see the waveform for that is B8ZS. So we have a BPV. BPV means where violations means polarity, bit sequence polarity we will use, and we have the normally we are inserting the actually again for four zeros as 000V, and for eight zeros 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 10, for eight zeros up to this we have added the sequence as 100V 100V. Okay, so a special sequence we have added for the 8 bits. In case of 4, we can also add 000V as used in the previous case. So the violations will distinguish a byte substituted for all the zeros from a normal byte which contains the 1. So B8ZS does not allow more than 8 consecutive zeros, and the bipolar violation pattern is uniquely identifies the 8 zeros. So this bipolar, this 100V, 100V for 8 consecutive zeros, this bipolar violation pattern, this is called as bipolar violation pattern for the 8 zeros, and it made that the voltage levels in the violating byte has a zero average value. Means we have a zero average value for this special sequence. Okay, so this was the waveform. For 1, it will be 1. For 0, it will be 0. And for next one, it will be of your alternate Mach inversion. So this will be negative polarity, then again 1, then 0, 0, then again negative polarity, then 1, then negative polarity for other one. Next is your 1. Another 1 polarity will be opposite. Then 0, 0, then for V, it will be negative polarity because the previous one has the positive polarity. So we have to do the alternate Mach inversion. Okay. So next is your 1, then next is 0, 0, then next is your again for with the opposite polarity, then last is your 0 0 will be drawn as simple. Okay, so this is the B8ZS your line code. Okay, so with this we have completed our line codes, and now we will discuss and summarize the advantages and disadvantages of all the line codes. Okay, now come on to the next slide. What are the various advantages of using the unipolar NRZ? Okay, now you know that NRZ stands for your non-return to zero, and unipolar, in which we will use only one voltage level, means plus A, and plus A will be for your positive and for one, and zero will be used for the zero. Okay, so advantages, what are the various advantages of unipolar NRZ? First is simplicity in the implementation. Second is it does not require a lot of bandwidth for the transmission. These were the some of the advantages of your unipolar. Next is what are the disadvantages. Disadvantages is that presence of DC level means we have some DC level also. Okay, so next is your it contains actually your low frequency components, so it causes the signal drop, means signal will be dropped. Next is your it does not have any error correction capability, means it can't correct any sequence, any incoming sequence at the receiver. Now does not possess any clocking component for ease of synchronization, means we have no clocking information in the case of your unipolar. And this is not transparent. Actually, this unipolar NRZ is not transparent, and long string of zero cause the loss of actually synchronization. Okay, these were the some of the advantages and disadvantages of unipolar NRZ. Next is unipolar RZ. In this case, what are the various advantages? First is implementation is simple. Then is a presence of spectral line at the symbol rate, which can cause the symbol timing clock signal. Means timing information is given in this case. Okay. Now next are the what are the disadvantages of unipolar RZ? So the disadvantage of unipolar RZ is your presence of DC level. Means again in this we have the DC value also. It should be zero, but there is some value of your DC. Okay. So next is continuous part is non-zero. Actually, your continuous part is non-zero because you due to the return to zero property. So it also causes the signal drop. Next is here, it does not have any correction capability. Okay, and it occupies actually the twice bandwidth as much required by your unipolar NRZ. You know that in the RZ, we have to return back in the signal. Okay, return back in the signal. So that's why it needs twice the bandwidth as compared to your unipolar NRZ. And it is not transparent. And this line coding is also not transparent. Next, come to the slide that is polar NRZ. In case of polar NRZ, what are the various advantages? First is simplicity in implementation. And there is no DC component. Okay, and the next disadvantage is continuous part in case of your polar NRZ is 0 hertz, so that's why signal will be dropped. And also it has no error correction capability and no clocking information in case of polar NRZ is provided. And also this type of line coding is also not transparent. Next is your polar RZ. Okay, polar RZ advantage is same as like polar NRZ. No DC component. Okay, and the disadvantages is it causes the signal drop and having no error correction capability, but it uses it twice the bandwidth due to the return to zero property. It uses it twice the bandwidth as compared to your polar NRZ. Okay, next is your bipolar signaling. Okay, bipolar signaling alternate Mach inversion is there. So it uses the three levels, plus V, zero and minus V. In the absence of zero, there will be absence of a pulse. And in case of one, alternating voltage levels, plus V and minus V for the one will be allotted. Okay, so now you can see bipolar NRZ. In case of bipolar NRZ, concentrate on the waveform. For first one, it is positive. For zero, it will be zero. For second one, it will be with alternate mark inversion means with opposite polarity, that is negative V. Then again zero, then one positive negative polarity was there. Now come on to the next will be it will be having the positive. So positive, negative, positive, negative, positive. Okay, and for zero it will be simply drawn as zero level. Okay, in the case of bipolar RZ, now you can see return to zero means in case of one it will be returned back to zero. So it will be high. Then for the half time period, it will be high. For the half time period, mid period, it will be returned to zero. And for zero, it will be simply make the zero level. Okay. Next is here for next one alternate mark inversion means positive one, then negative one, then again for zero, it will be then this will be returned to zero. So again it will be here. Return to zero. This will be here. Goes to zero. Then next is zero. Then again alternate mark inversion one. Then for half time period it will be high. For second half it will be low. Then positive, negative, and positive. And return to zero with the return to zero property. And draw the zero for last. Okay. So this was the waveform for the bipolar RZ. Now, what are the various advantages of your bipolar signaling? First is no DC component and it requires actually less bandwidth more than your unipolar and polar NRZ schemes. And it does not suffer from the signal drop because it is suitable for the transmission over the your AC coupled lines also. Means we can, AC coupled lines can also send the signals, okay, use this line coding. Okay, then it possesses the single error detection capability. So we can detect the errors because we know that for the ones we have the property with the alternate mark inversion, because if first one is yours with positive polarity drawn, then second one should be drawn with the opposite polarity, that is negative polarity. Okay. Next is disadvantages. So disadvantages is that no clocking information is there and the synchronization problem will be there and it is not transparent. Okay. Next is your Manchester coding. Okay. In case of your Manchester coding, what are the various advantages? The various advantages in case of Manchester coding is, first is your actually no DC component. Okay. Next, it also does not suffer from the signal drop. Then it can be easy to synchronize. Then it is transparent. Okay. Next is, what are the various disadvantages? The various disadvantages of Manchester coding are, first is because of the greater number of transitions, because there are so many transitions in case of your Manchester. So it requires a large bandwidth. Okay. And this, and also it does not have the error detection capability. So this was the Manchester coding and coding advantages and disadvantages. Okay, now come on to the performance comparison. Okay, in case of your performance comparison, now you can see that in the last lecture I have shown that AK was the coefficient. So in case of AK unipolar NRZ, for symbol 0 AK will be your 0 and for AK will be equal to capital A, that is means amplitude, and the basic pulse will be of your rectangular time. And in case of polar RZ NRZ, AK will be minus A and AK will be positive A for symbol 1, and pulse of unit amplitude this will be, and the duration for that is TB. Okay. Next is bipolar NRZ. Okay. For that, for symbol 0 AK coefficient will be 0, or it can be A or negative A. Okay. Because this is the alternate mark inversion. Next is Manchester. Manchester, in case of Manchester, symbol 0 will be represented as minus A and 1 will be represented as your plus A. And it consists of your double pulses, actually amplitude of plus minus 1, and duration may be of that year, that pulse will be your TB. Okay. Next is in the case of polar quaternary. we have for 00 code, we have -3 a by 2, and for 1, we have the means 01, we have the amplitude minus a by 2. So this is also a rectangular pulse, and pulse of unit amplitude and having the duration 2b, because 2 bits are transmitted. Okay, next is here. Now the performance comparison. Of your various discrete PAM formats. Okay, now we will do the performance comparison on the basis of this diagram. This is the diagram of the PAM, various PAM format. And this diagram shows the power spectral density actually of different line cores. These show the power spectral density of your different line cores. Okay, so in this case, in the first case, in the case of your NRZ bipolar, means first case, that is waveform A. This is the waveform A. This dotted is your waveform A. In this case, we have a both the power spectral density and your power spectral density and your frequency. In this case, in the case of NRZ unipolar, they are normalized. Okay, and the most of the power in the case of NRZ unipolar format is concentrated between the DC and bit rate of the input data. Okay, now come on to the curve B. This is the curve B. As you can see, this is in the solid line. This is the curve B. Okay, so in this case, curve B, this shows the power spectra of the NRZ polar format. This is for the polar NRZ. And here also, actually, like unipolar NRZ format, most of the power lies actually in the main lobe, okay, of the sink shape. So this is like a sink signal. So sink shape, okay. So the main lobe extends up to the main lobe. Your main lobe can be extends up to the bit rate of 1/TB. Next is your C graph C curve C. Okay, now come on to the curve C. This is for the NRZ bipolar or AMI format. Okay, so in this case, we can see that almost all the power lies inside the bandwidth of bandwidth equal to 1/TB. So you can see, now you can see in this case, we have, this is the TB. This is the TB about 1. At 1, this is the 1/TB. Similar to two NRZ formats. Which we have discussed earlier, like NRZ unipolar, NRZ polar, we have a spectral component of NRZ bipolar format is relatively small, okay, relatively small as compared to around the zero frequency, it is small. Actually, next is your D. D is your Manchester. So this is your curve D. This curve is your D. Okay, so in the curve D, this shows the power spectra of your Manchester format. So in this case, power lies inside the bandwidth equal to 2b, where 2 by TB. Sorry, 2/TB. As you can see, this is 2, so 2/TB. So frequency is 2, so 2/TB, which is twice the bandwidth of the, means it uses it twice the bandwidth of the unipolar, polar, and bipolar NRZ. Means above 3, from the above 3, it uses the double bandwidth. Okay, so this was the performance comparison of your various discrete PAM formats on the basis of power spectrum. Okay, next is your, now you can see also the comparison of line codes in the case in the tabular form. Now you can see this is the comparison of polar RZ, polar NRZ, AMI, and Manchester. So transmission of DC component is always in the case of your present, always in the case of your polar RZ, polar NRZ. I have already discussed with you. But in case of AMI and Manchester, there will be no DC component. Now signaling rate. For polar, it will be 1/TB. For polar NRZ, it will be 1/TB. For AMI also, it 1/TB, and for Manchester it will be also 1/TB. Now noise immunity in case of polar RZ and polar NRZ will be low, and for in case of your AMI and Manchester it will be high. Means means your noise factor is your is less in this case your AMI and Manchester. Next is synchronization capability. Synchronization capability in the polar RZ and NRZ will be poor, and here in case of AMI and Manchester we have the very good synchronization capability. Next is bandwidth required. In case of polar RZ, this will be 1/TB, and in case of polar NRZ it will be 1/2 TB. For AMI it is also 1/2 TB, and for Manchester it will be 1/TB. Then last is your crosstalk. Okay, crosstalk for the polar RZ will be your high. Polar RZ and polar NRZ crosstalk will be high, and in case of AMI and Manchester it will be your low. So crosstalk is actually when two signals interfere with each other. Okay, that is called as your crosstalk. Okay, now you can see this is again comparison done with the polar quaternary NRZ. In this table, polar quaternary NRZ is also included. So transmission of DC component is possible in this case. Signaling rate is 1/2 TB. Noise, because in this case we are sending the 2 bits at a time. Okay, 2 bits at a time. So noise immunity is high. Synchronization capability is poor in the case of polar quaternary. And bandwidth requirement is 1/2 TB. And the crosstalk in this case is also low. So these were the some of the your performance comparison of various line codes. Okay. Next is, what is the difference between the source coding and your line coding? Actually, source coding actually like the example for the source coding is like PCM, delta modulation, adaptive delta modulation. These all are under the category of the source coding. And the source coding actually is a technique in which we are converting your analog signal into digital coded equivalent signal. And the output of the source code, coder is your train of your binary digits, zeros and ones. Whereas your line coding techniques convert your stream of your binary digits into a format of code which is more suitable for the transmission. Okay. So which is more suitable for the transmission over a cable or any other medium. So data transmission must satisfy the certain requirements such as synchronization, elimination of DC component, low crosstalk. So we will convert your digital stream which is coming from the source coding to a suitable format so that we can transmit. Okay, without the with the synchronization and elimination of your DC component, and you are with less low crosstalk. Okay, and the example for the line coding are, we have already done unipolar RZ, NRZ, bipolar RZ, NRZ, Manchester, AMI. These all are under the category of your line code. Okay, so with this we have completed our line coding. Next is your some of the important parameters. Okay, some of the important parameters of your line codes. Okay, so first parameters is your DC component. So all the cable systems and other communication systems do not allow actually transmission of a DC signal. So therefore, line signal must be have your zero average DC value. So NRZ actually bipolar format usually satisfy this requirement. So for this reason, long strings of element sequences have same polarity should not be transmitted. So means DC component in this case should be zero, having the zero average value. Next is your self clocking capability. So any digital communication system needs symbol or your bit synchronization, and to ensure your synchronization at the receiver, actually the line code waveform must undergo a sufficient number of zeros crossing. So means your signal should cross the zero. Okay, so that means the waveform must always undergo the transition. There will be always be the transitions in the waveform. Okay, so this is known as inherent synchronization or clocking feature, and some of the codes having this feature like Manchester. Okay, next is your error detection. So some of the line codes such as Dew binary, provides the means of detecting the data errors and without the introducing any additional error detection bits into the data sequence. So do you find the line code can be used for the error detection purposes? Next is your due binding means in which you are sending the 2 bits at a time. Okay. Next is bandwidth compression. Okay, bandwidth compression. The bandwidth of a line code should be small as small possible. So multi-level codes need less bandwidth as compared to the other codes. This happens due to the effective utilization of your bandwidth. Next is your differential encoding. Okay, next is your differential. Next parameter is differential encoding. In this case, it is useful for those communication systems where the transmitted waveform sometimes experiences an inversion. So in differential encoding, the polarity of the encoded waveform is inverted without affecting the your data detection. Okay. Now next is your next parameter is noise immunity. So selected PAM format or PCM format should have a high noise immunity. Means it has the ability to minimize the effect of the noise. So this is the necessity to have minimum number of errors introduced due to the noise, and the NRZ formats have better noise immunity than that of your unipolar RZ format. Next is your minimum crosstalk. Okay, the crosstalk between the adjacent channels that are being transmitted should be minimized. To achieve this, the amount of energy in the signal at low frequency should be small. Means if you get this minimum crosstalk, then amount of energy in the signal at the low frequency should be small. So these were the some of the important parameters of your line codes. Next, we will do the inter-symbol interference. Okay, now we will do the next concept, that is inter-symbol interference. Actually, we know that in a communication system, when the data is being transmitted in the form of pulses, so the output produced at the receiver due to other bits or symbols which are interfered with the output produced by the desired bit. So this is known as actually inter-symbol interference, in which other bits and symbols interface with the output, okay, with your actual output. So inter-symbol interference will introduce the errors in the detected signal. Okay, so now let us consider we are having the PAM elements, actually means binding PAM system, and that this shows the various elements which are used. So input signal actually consists of a binding sequence BK. Okay, we have a input sequence. You can see input binary data we are taking as BK with the duration. With the bit duration is your TB seconds, and with the duration of your TB seconds. So this sequence actually, so this sequence is applied to the pulse generator, and which will produce a discrete PAM signal, that is your XT. And the expression for the XT is this. So XT will be your K is approaches to minus infinity to infinity, AK VT minus KTB. Okay, where VT is your denotes the basic pulse, and this is normalized. This is not at the normalized value. This will be means that is VT at V0. It will be its value will be your 1. So this is the first block of the system. Means pulse generator is the first block of the system. We will get the XT. And that is your pulse amplitude modulator converts this input sequence into the polar form. Means this actually sequence will be converted into polar form here. Okay. Now if your BK is 1, where we have 2 cases. If your BK is 1, then AK will be 1. And if your BK is 0, then AK will be equal to minus 1. Because we are using the polar. Actually, we are using the polar. Okay. So now you know that the PAM signal XT, then this PAM signal XT, this PAM signal XT is transferred to, or you can say is passed through a transmitting filter, and the output of the transmitting filter is then transmitted over a transmission channel. Okay, we will send it on the transmission channel. Okay, and let us suppose we have a actually impulse response, and we know that in the impulse response is always denoted by your HT. Okay, in the DSP it is written as HN, but in case of signal system it is written as your HT. In the time period it will be written as your HT. Okay, so a random noise, actually a random noise is your random noise means white Gaussian noise is your random noise is then added to this transmitted signal when it actually travels over the transmission channel. Okay, when it actually transmission over the channel. Okay, so the received signal at the receiving end is contaminated with your noise. Okay, means your signal may be composed of your noise also. So channel output is actually passed through our sieving filter. At the receiver side, we will pass this information to the sieving filter. So filter output is sampled. Actually, we will do sampling here. So filter output is sampled synchronously with the transmitter. Okay, and the sampling instants actually are determined by a clock for the timing signal. And this means we can determine by the sampling instance can be determined by the your clock or timing signal, and which can be extracted, and we can extract that signal from the receiving filter output. Okay, we can extract that signal from the receiving filter output. This switch will be act as a sampling. Okay, and this switch will be act as a sampling. So the sequence of the samples obtained at the output of the receiving filter is used to reconstruct the original signal with the help of a device which is known as your decision device. And each sample is compared to a threshold level. In this case, we have a threshold level, and we will compare our incoming signal with that threshold. Okay. So if the amplitude of the sample is higher than that this threshold level, then it will be decided at as symbol 1 is received. On the other hand, the symbol 0 will be received if your amplitude of the received signal is less than your threshold. Okay, so at the receiving filter we have the output like this. Yt is equal to micro k minus infinity to infinity ak Pt minus Ktb plus Nt. Nt is your noise at the output of the receiving filter due to the added noise. And micro is your scaling factor. And term Ptk by T minus Ktb represents the combined impulse response of your receiving filter. Okay, filter have the always the impulse response. Okay, you know that. Okay, so with this let us suppose we have a receiving filter output yt is sampled at the sampled. If I will sample my receiving output at the receiving filter, so if I will sample at the ti is equal to itb, let us suppose time at which I am sampling the signal, that is itb. Ti means sampling instant time is here. If I will take ITB with I taking on the integer values, I am taking that on the integer values. So T will be put as ITB. So in the next expression, micro minus K minus infinity to infinity AK same as AK PT. In place of T, I will put as your T will be sampling time will be ITB. Minus of KTB plus N of TI. I am sampling at the N is equal to T is equal to TI and TI is equal to ITB. Further TI is equal to ITB. So I have put all the values. So YTI is equal to, because I am calculating on this instant. So YTI is equal to micro of AI. I have taking the this vector separately, micro AI plus micro K is equal to, here in this case, K is not equal to I, because K is equal to I, I have taken this case separate out. Okay, K is equal to I for not of KI and limit minus infinity to infinity AKP ITB minus KTB plus NTI. So this expression will be same. only the factor I have taken as k is equal to I. I have written this factor outside. Okay. So this is the sewer output at. So this is the sewer output at yt at the instant of ti. Okay. So it may be noted that we have two terms, micro AI. Okay, which is produced by the ith transmitted bit. And theoretically, actually, only this term should be present. Actually, this term only should be present. Rest of should be zero. However, practically, it is not possible. So now the second term represents a residual effect of all the transmitted bits, means interference actually. Okay, so obtained at the time of your sampling the ith bit. So this shows, the second term shows the residual effect of all the transmitted bits which are obtained at the time of your sampling the ith bit. So this residual effect is known as your ISI, means this extra factor which is added at the receiver, which is finded at the receiver. Okay, that is your, this residual effect is called as your ISI. We should have only this value at the receiver, but we are getting extra term with this. Okay, due to the interfering of all the signals, or you can say residual effects of all the transmitted bits. So this is called as your ISI. Now come on to the next topic, that is, what are the factors, which factors are responsible for the ISI. Okay, so you know that the inter-symbol interference actually arises due to the imperfections in the overall frequency response of the system. So when a short pulse of duration TB seconds is transmitted through a band limited system, then the frequency components contained in the input pulse are differentially actually attenuated, and more importantly, differentially delayed by the system, means these will be delayed. So now you can see this is the width of the pulse TB, but this is duration longer than TB. Okay, so it is dispersed. So here, due to this, your pulse appearing at the output of the system will be dispersed over an interval which is longer than your TB. Okay, so when transmitted over the communication channel, so signal will interfere with each other, and this will result in the ISI. So the transmitted pulse of duration TB seconds and dispersed pulse of duration more than TB seconds are shown. Okay, so TB and more than TB are shown. So this shows that ISI effect is there. Okay, so now you can see that. Now next is effect of, what are the various effect of your ISI. So first effect is that in the absence of ISI and noise, the transmitted bit can be decoded correctly at the receiver. Okay, next is the presence of ISI will introduce the errors in the decision at the receiver output. Hence, the receiver can make an error in deciding whether it is received as logic 1 or logic 0. Okay, now what are the remedy? What is the remedy to reduce the your ISI? Okay, it actually, we have proved that the function which produces a zero inter-symbol interference is your sync function. Actually, sync function have the property that it can produce zero inter-symbol interference, sync function. So hence, instead of your rectangular pulse, if we transmit a sync pulse, then ISI can be reduced to zero. Means we have to, we will use sync function, then your ISI will be reduced to zero. So this is known as your Nyquist pulse shaping, and the sync pulse transmitted to have a zero ISI, that is your shown in this diagram. And further, we know that your Fourier transform of, you know that your Fourier transform in the signal system, we know that the Fourier transform of your sync function is your always your rectangular function. Means if I will do the Fourier transform of your sync function, it will give you the rectangular function. So hence, to preserve all the frequency components, the frequency response of the filter must be exactly flat in the pass band and zero. It should be zero in the attenuation band. Means in the attenuation band, we have the zero response of the filter should be there, and in the pass band, it should have the flat response. Means you can see this is the zero response, this is the flat response in the bandwidth. Okay. So next is, so you can see that sync function is an option. Okay. However, actually type, this type of filter is not possible. Okay. We can't get the sync function as a, we can't have us using the sync function properly with the filter. So hence in practice frequency response, we are not getting this exact response with the sync function. Even we are getting some another form. Now you can see in this, we have some form like this. We are not exactly getting this type of, this is the ideal, but this is the actually practically we are getting. So hence in practice, the frequency response of your filter is modified with the different role of your factor alpha. So this is for the case for the alpha 0. This is for the alpha is your 1 by 2. We will get like this. And if your alpha is 1, so we will get like the waveform with, response will be like this. So this was the actually a remedy to the actually reduce the ISI. Okay. Now next is concept is I pattern. Next concept is your I pattern. Now, what is I pattern actually? I pattern is a pattern displayed on the screen of a CRO, and the shape of this pattern actually resembles with the shape of human eye. That's why this is known as your I pattern. So therefore, it is called as your I pattern. I pattern is actually practically is a practical way to study the inter-symbol interference. Means if you want to study the inter-symbol interference, then we have to study the I pattern. Practical way to describe your, to study the inter-symbol interference, that is your I pattern. So it affects on a PCM, means effect of a ISI on a PCM or data communication system. We can analyze that with the help of I pattern. So I pattern is obtained on the CRO by applying the received signal to the vertical deflection. So we will, so this is your binary data we are sending, 1010, this is in the distorted form. Okay, this signal is given. Okay, this signal is given to the your CRO by applying the C signal to the vertical deflection plate. So you can see received data signal, and we have a sawtooth your wave at rate 1 by TB. This is CRO and this is the I. Okay, this is the I diagram. Okay, so we are I pattern is obtained on CRO by applying the CF signal to the vertical deflection plates. That is your Y. That is your capital Y. Okay. And of the CRO and a sawtooth wave at the transmission symbol rate, which is the transmission at the symbol rate 1 by TB to the horizontal deflection plates. Okay. You know that in CRO, we have two plates with horizontal deflection plates and one is your vertical deflection plates. At the horizontal deflection plates, we will give this sawtooth wave having the bit rate 1 by TB. Okay. So received signal and the corresponding oscilloscope display are shown. So this shown. Okay. So the resulting oscilloscope is called as your I pattern. And this is due to actually resembles to the human eye. So that's why this is known as your I pattern. And the anterior region means this is the anterior region of your eye. So this is the interior region of your eye, means opening of eye. Okay, so that is called interior region of the eye is known as your opening of eye opening. Okay, and the eye pattern, which is actually they actually gives us the information about the performance of the system, because it analyzes the ISI. It analyzes the effect of your ISI. Okay, so you can see information obtained. We can obtain the information in this form 101101. So this will be given to the CRO like this. This sequence will be given on the Y, and we have a I pattern like this. Okay, now come on to the this is the gazette your I pattern. So you can see that in this case some of the informations we are getting from this I pattern. This is the slope sensitivity to the timing error. This is the margin over noise. This is distortion at the sampling time. This is the best sampling time. Okay, and the, this is the distortion. This is the distortion of the zero crossing, and this interval shows the time interval over which the wave can be sampled, means TB. That is okay. From this diagram, we came to the some important points. We came to know first is your width of the eye opening. Actually, this width of the eye opening, this from this to this. So, width of the eye opening defines the time interval over which the received wave can be sampled without an error. Means in this case, with eye opening is the time interval for which we can receive wave can be sampled without any error due to the ISI. So best time for sampling is when the eye is your open widest. Okay. So next point is sensitivity of the system to the timing error is determined by the rate of closure of the eye as the sampling rate is varied. Okay. So closing of the eye shows the sensitivity of the system. Okay. And the height, actually height of the eye opening. Height of the eye opening shows the this height of the eye pattern shows the specific your sampling time. Okay. Means how much time you can sample your signal. Okay. So which defines the actually margin also. Okay, which defines the margin over noise also. Next is your with the when the effect of your ISI is severe. In this case, if your ISI effect is severe, then eye is completely closed. Means if your ISI effect is too much high in your signal, then your eye will be closed and it is impossible to avoid errors due to the combined presence of your ISI and noise. Means if your signal has both vectors, means ISI and noise both, then combined presence of your ISI and noise in the system, in this case, it is impossible to avoid the errors. So this was the eye pattern. Okay, with this we have completed our topics line coding, ISI and eye pattern. Okay, next we will do in the next lecture. Thank you.